Up next, author Kenneth C. Davis discusses his book, The Hidden History of America at War. He explores the challenges the U.S. military faced from the Revolutionary War to the war in Iraq. Mr. Davis also argues there are many popular misconceptions about the American Revolution and the Civil and Vietnam Wars. The Francis Tavern Museum in New York City hosted the event. It's about an hour.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you so much for coming. I'm always so pleased when I hear someone has read, don't know much about history when they were, you know, a teenager 20 years ago or something like that. It makes me feel so young. And I run into this a lot. Oh, I read your book when I was 16, and I'm 40 now. That's why it's a 25th anniversary edition, and it's been a while. Oh, thank you all for coming. It's a thrill and an honor to be here in Francis Tavern. I am a lover of all places historical. I have been since I was a small child. In fact, when I was a kid, our idea of summer vacation was throwing some mummy sleeping bags, army surplus mummy bags, and an old canvas tent in the back of the car, and we'd go off to places like Fort Ticonderoga in upstate New York, or Gettysburg, or Valley Forge. And visiting those places as a kid gave me the sense that history is not something that happens in books. History happens to real people in real places. And that is the idea that has driven me throughout my career, to make history as exciting, interesting, but most of all human as it was for me when I was a child. And I stood in the battle at the battlefield of Gettysburg. I remember it honestly like it was yesterday. It was more than a few years ago. It was 1963, in fact, the centennial anniversary of the Battle of Gettysburg. And I remember being a child and standing there, not really fully understanding, of course, what the Civil War was about and what the Gettysburg Address was about and what had really happened at Gettysburg, but knowing in my heart that as I stood there, feeling that summer heat in that wheat field with those stones, and if you've been there, they are unforgettable, I knew that something extraordinary had happened here and that this was a sacred place. I took home from that visit in 1963 a small wooden revolver, a toy souvenir, and it had the dates of the battle stamped on the barrel. And I swear I still have that souvenir on my desk, and I keep it as a reminder of that sense that I had as a child of what history really means. And when I set out to write Don't Know Much About History, more than 25 years ago now, it's hard for me to believe, but when I started to set out, I wanted to maintain that sense of almost childlike wonder that I had about history, because I couldn't understand people saying to me, oh, history, it was so dull, it was so boring, it was all those dates and battles and speeches, because history is anything but that. History is the story of real people in real places, and when you are in a place like this, and the history is palpable, it gives me that feeling, and I'm sure many of you have that same feeling. It is wonderful to be here, especially in this flag room, because, as you know, Jennifer just mentioned it, Sunday officially is Flag Day. But it's also, more importantly, also for my purposes here tonight, June 14th is the 240th anniversary of the birth of the U.S. Army. And we'll talk about that a little bit tonight, but I want to just reflect on the flags for just a moment, because there's so much mythology, and that's one of the things we'll be talking about tonight, is the mythology that permeates our history too often, but the mythology, of course, of this flag and how it came to be. One of my favorite characters, real people in history, is a man named Francis Hopkinson, signer of the Declaration of Independence. Well, it was Hopkinson who actually takes credit for designing the so-called Betsy Ross flag. The legend grew up, of course, about Betsy Ross stitching up this flag. That was a family story that was handed down for generations, not published for more than 100 years after the Revolution. And then it turned out that someone came across this bill that Hopkinson, a signer of the Declaration, had submitted to the Congress for the design of the flag. And this was cited as sort of evidence of his actual hand in designing the stars and stripes, more or less as we know it. It was interesting because Hopkinson actually asked in payment for his services for a quarter cask of the public wine. Well, I was very interested in this for a number of reasons. I didn't know we had a public wine in 1775 and 1777 when Hopkinson submitted the bill. They turned him down, by the way. They said he was already on the congressional payroll, so he wasn't going to receive extra pay. But the case of wine is interesting because here we are in this tavern. And as I am sure many of you know, George Washington was not a man who would ever turn down a fine glass of port. And I'm sure on that evening in December 1783, when he said his farewells here, I'm sure the port was passed around. What you may not know, perhaps if you've been to Mount Vernon, you've seen it, I have been there recently, is that by the time he retired from the presidency, George Washington was America's largest distiller of whiskey. He owned a distillery that he'd set up at Mount Vernon, and it was producing about 11,000 gallons of whiskey a year by around 1800. So Washington had become owner of the largest distillery in America at that time. And since this came just a few years after he'd marched out to suppress the whiskey rebellion, those farmers who didn't want to pay taxes on whiskey, kind of interesting. I believe that Washington paid the taxes on the whiskey he produced. But it brings me to Washington and being here and this extraordinary place where he did say farewell on 1783. But I want to take you back to the other end of the story, the day he becomes commander of the U.S. Army. Well, we should back up a little bit, of course, and refresh ourselves on the dates and the setting and the scene here a little bit. April 19th, 1775, of course, the shots are fired at Lexington and Concord. The shots heard round the world, as Emerson later put it. Washington was on his way to Philadelphia at that time for the second Continental Congress. He knew that this really meant that war was going to be coming. By the time he arrives in Philadelphia, wearing a blue army suit, by the way, a blue military uniform that he had made for him. He did have military experience, but certainly it was a not too subtle hint of his own ambitions and interests as he came to Philadelphia. Certainly he was the only one wearing any sort of military uniform in Philadelphia in 1775. By the way, the uniform was made for him by a Scottish tailor named Andrew Judge. And Andrew Judge is interesting in history because he was an indentured servant. And he worked at Washington's Mount Vernon plantation as a tailor. He had a child with one of Washington's enslaved people. That child's name was Oney Judge. She comes down to us in history. And this is a little bit of a departure, but since it's so fascinating and it does fit in with what I'm going to be talking about tonight in terms of Yorktown and Washington, Oney Judge was the only slave who escaped from Philadelphia while Washington was president. So the man who made Washington's uniform that he goes off to Philadelphia in is the father of a slave who at the age of about 22 runs away from Washington. This is the true story of American history that is so much better than any novel could be. And these are the fascinating threads that I try and find and weave through these histories, through these stories that I've written about and told in my books. But as I was mentioning, the feeling that I get here, the palpable feeling of being in a place where Washington stood, and being in a place where Henry Knox, his chief of artillery, stood with him alongside that night that he said goodbye to his officers, really does connect us back to that personal history that history should be about. Because for all too many people, as I mentioned, I hear it all the time, it's so dull, it's so boring, it's just that a lot of dates and battles and memorizing speeches and court decisions. But that's not what history is about. History is about what real people do. And Walt Whitman, the somber poet of the Civil War, who actually was served as a volunteer nurse during the Civil War, once said, "The real war will never get in the books." And I've had that in my mind for many years as I've tried to write, and certainly as I've written this new book, which is called The Hidden History of America at War. And all of these things come together because these are the stories about real people. This is the real war getting in the books. The story in The Hidden History of America at War is essentially the story of who fights our battles, who goes to war for us, and ultimately why we go to war. Those are really important questions that we should all be asking ourselves. And I do this by talking about six stories of six battles through American history, from the Battle of Yorktown in 1781, right through the Battle of Fallujah in Iraq in 2004. So more than 230 years of American history, American military history, told through the lens of these six battles. But what I've tried to do is get behind some of the stories your school books probably left out, what I call the hidden history. And certainly in the first story in the book, the story of Yorktown, which is what I'm going to focus on tonight, that is the essence of what we all learned maybe back in school days, that George Washington won the Battle of Yorktown. Yes, that's true. It was the supreme moment of his triumph. But what they didn't tell you in school, and I'll talk to you about in my book, is how Washington did that. First of all, he didn't do it alone. He had the help of a French navy and a French army that was actually larger than any American army that was on the battlefield. He also had the help of African-American soldiers, very important part of the story at Yorktown. One of the other pieces of the story that I like to expand on a little bit here tonight is what happened after the Battle of Yorktown was over, when Washington made sure that he recovered 5,000 or 6,000 African-American slaves who were with the British in Yorktown that day during the battle. These included 17 people from Mount Vernon, Washington's own plantation, as well as about two dozen from Jefferson's plantation at Monticello. He made sure they were all returned as property that belonged to people in the state. This is the side of the story that's important to understand, and it's the side of the story that gets left out of our school books, and it's all too important to understand, especially these days. But let's go back to that moment in Philadelphia when Washington is standing around in his blue uniform and the word comes down on April 14th, 1775 that the Congress has adopted these soldiers, militiamen up in Boston who have been fighting the British, and they are going to become the first Continental Army. They also raise a company of riflemen from a few of the other states so that this would truly be a United States Army to send them up. And then the question is, who is going to take command? Well, Washington certainly had his own ambitions and his own ideas as he was standing there in his blue uniform. But another gentleman who was in that room also had ambitions to lead the army. His name was John Hancock. We don't think of John Hancock as a great military leader, and indeed he wasn't. He'd actually led the militia in some training in Massachusetts. And there's Hancock sitting and waiting and expecting that his two good friends from Massachusetts, John Adams and Samuel Adams, after all, he and Samuel Adams had escaped the British on that day in April of 1775 when the British came out to arrest them. He was quite sure that Samuel Adams was going to put his name in nomination to command the army. Well, John Adams gets up first and suggests, indeed, that it should be George Washington who leads the army. Hancock's face, really. The records show that his jaw truly dropped at the sound of this. And then Samuel Adams gets up and seconds the nomination, and it was quite unanimous very quickly. Hancock and Adams really never got along too well after that. It was a fracture that they never got over. So it's part of the idea that ambition and ego and all of those things that we know play a part in politics and life today were just as true of these men that we call the founding fathers. They all had ambitions, they all had egos, they all had agendas. And that's the side of the story that I love to find and tell. When we get to Yorktown then, 1775, Washington rides off, goes up to Cambridge in July, taking with him, of course, one gentleman, young gentleman named Billy Lee, who did not wear a uniform. He was wearing the servant's livery of Mount Vernon. He was a slave. He stayed with Washington every single day of the Revolution through all the disappointments and disasters and defeats. Valley Forge, he shivered there with practically no uniform on, no clothes on. And Lee is there watching all of this. And so we have this, again, this great contradiction of Washington leading the fight for liberty and freedom and equality, yet keeping a man in slave bondage beside him every minute of the way. It's a contradiction that we have to discuss and we have to understand and we have to talk about. So we shift then to 6 years later. Yorktown is over. Washington has won the war. But who actually did win that war? Who won the American Revolution? Well, we say the Americans, of course. But in the lore of American history, and especially on historic holidays like Patriots Day in April or Flag Day and the 4th of July, the legendary Minutemen get most of the credit. Those embattled farmers, that, as Ralph Waldo Emerson described them. They, of course, shouldered their trusty muskets as soon as the alarm bells rang, ready in a minute to run off, dropped their farm tools and took off their shopkeeper's aprons, and they beat back the mighty redcoats with the shot heard round the world. Then they quickly entered America's patriotic post-war legend as these kind of populist heroes who secured America's liberty and the right to bear arms. We'll come back to that in a minute. It's a grand story, and it's one to certainly feel proud of. But like most schoolbook history that's conjured up more than two centuries ago, it is as much mythology as myth. As John Adams fretted after the war, the history of our revolution will be one continued lie from one end to the other. There's no arguing that the locals who rushed out to Lexington on Concord on that April morning performed heroically, but it's only a small piece of a much larger story. After the revolution was over, politicians were very eager to flatter voters. Imagine that. Politicians who want to flatter voters by promoting the militia, the Minutemen, as these part-time citizen soldiers over the regulars of that Continental Army that Washington had formed in 1775, who had done most of the fighting and suffering. So this idea that it's these militiamen who win the war is a story that's woven together by politicians and poets and agreeable historians for most of the world, for most of the history ever since. It's a myth that's rooted, however, in a very deep distrust and disdain for standing armies that America's founding generation had. And it carried over for many years into the way we saw soldiers in this country and the way we treated them, both during the war and afterwards. And that's one of the things I focus most in this book, how we treat the men for most of our history, and certainly the women now, who actually wear the uniform and do the fighting. The question of who actually fought was an urgent one for Washington, who would fight, was an urgent one for Washington when he takes over in 1775. He got up to Massachusetts and saw 15,000 men, more or less, kind of wandering around. They were disorderly, they were disorganized, they didn't know how to dig trenches for latrines. He saw officers giving haircuts to enlisted men. He saw enlisted men voting on who was going to be their officers. He came out of the British military tradition, and he knew that this was not going to do. But he was very, very frightened of the idea that he'd have to defeat the British Army, perhaps the most powerful military force on earth at the time, with these amateur, disorganized, and very, very ill-trained men, some of whom were black with guns, and he was going to put a stop to that as well. Washington was not going to allow blacks to enlist in his Continental Army, at least in the beginning. By 1776, he was really concerned about this army that he had inherited, and he in fact wrote to Congress, "To place any dependence upon the militia is assuredly resting upon a broken staff." Not quite the picture that we have of those brave men, is it? The broken staff. And after his disastrous defeats a little bit later in 1776, right here in New York, of course, Thomas Paine, who was the great pamphleteer of the Revolution, said, "The summer soldier and the sunshine patriot will, in this crisis, shrink from the service of their country." Well, Paine's summer soldier and his sunshine patriot, these were the militiamen. They were eager to head home. They were summer soldiers. They had signed on for a few months, only as long as they had put their seed in. They could go off for a while, and then they had to get back for the harvest. This wasn't going to do for Washington. He was right, of course, Paine. Following that first blush of patriotic fervor around the country when men were eager to join very suddenly, there was something troubling. Even places like Concord and Lexington had trouble rounding up their quota of citizen soldiers who were willing to serve. So the performance of these militias, these citizen soldiers, the so-called Minutemen, was often unreliable, amateurish, or worse, despite some heroic moments. Recruitment was troubled. In Rhode Island, for instance, they couldn't get enough men to reach their enlistment quotas. So what did they do? They created the first Rhode Island Regiment, which was essentially a group of emancipated slaves who were given their freedom in exchange for service, and their owners were compensated. This was something Washington very, very slowly agreed to, but he knew he needed some more bodies in his army, so he was willing to accept this one outstanding example of African Americans serving. He certainly didn't want to make it a nationwide or army-wide issue. He knew that Southern slaveholders, his fellow slaveholders from places like South Carolina and Georgia and Virginia, were not going to agree to the idea of arming black men. At the other end of the scale, from the black soldiers who were being enlisted and recruited to serve and being emancipated from slavery, were the militias in places like Virginia, where men were afraid to leave their homes to go off and defend their states, because they are afraid if they left, their slaves would leave. So militias in places like Virginia had really terrible service records during the war, and Thomas Jefferson learned this, of course, in 1781, when he was chased out of the capital city of Richmond by a British army led by none other than Benedict Arnold. Isn't history wonderful? Benedict Arnold is in Virginia with handcuffs for Thomas Jefferson in 1781. They didn't tell me that in my school books, I don't know. So the Revolution, in other words, was won by an army that is not the one that's depicted in the patriotic paintings we have. In fact, one Frenchman in 1781 writes, "It's truly incredible that troops almost naked, poorly paid, composed of old men and children and Negroes, should behave so well on the march and under fire. But it simply would not do to have the story of America's freedom won by a collection of out-of-work, landless teenagers, recent immigrants, including the Germans and the Irish, who were also detested because they were also Catholic, and African Americans, who served despite Washington's resistance to the idea of giving guns to black men. I will point out, I'm so glad that I'm here to talk about this tonight, that Lafayette is on display here. Lafayette is a major figure in the first chapter of this book about Yorktown and Washington's men, because Lafayette, one of the true great idealists of the American Revolution, was completely devoted to the ideal of abolition and emancipation. So I'm so thrilled that there's a Lafayette display here, and I urge you to learn more about this really extraordinary character who was such a hero in our nation's creation. But back to this idea of the Minuteman myth, this noble idea that part-time soldiers and militias had won America's freedom. It was soon carved in stone by the founders, who really disliked regular armies. Why? They're a threat to freedom, and an expensive one at that. Thomas Jefferson, the same guy who got chased out of Virginia by an army when the militia wouldn't stand up for him, said in that same year that an army and a navy would lead to that load of military expense which makes the European laborer go supperless to bed. In other words, Jefferson didn't want to pay for an army. These men had also seen what kings could do, and they considered professional soldiers the dregs of society. They knew the history of Rome and what an ambitious military leader with an army at his back could do. But their mistrust emerged throughout the Revolution in ways that the men who fought were treated, both during the war and its immediate aftermath. After the Revolution, in 1783, just as Washington is here, getting ready to come here to New York, as the British are getting ready to leave, officers upstate in Newburgh, New York, are very, very unhappy. They haven't been paid, they haven't gotten the pensions they were promised, and they were as close as we've come in this country's history to a military coup. And it's to Washington's everlasting credit that he goes up to Newburgh, New York, and suppresses this so-called Newburgh conspiracy. A few months later, in June of 1783, a couple of hundred men in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, enlisted men, are upset because they haven't been paid. So they march on Philadelphia, which was then the capital, where Congress is meeting. And they stop off at a few of the tippling houses on the way, so they were well-oiled by the time they reached the Congress. And there, Alexander Hamilton, a veteran, also a character in the first chapter in this book, because he was one of the heroes of Yorktown, Alexander Hamilton is arguing that the men should be paid, they should get their pensions. It's falling on deaf ears. The army, these soldiers, actually force Hamilton and the rest of Congress, including James Madison, to flee. They leave Philadelphia for months and go to Princeton nearby. A few years later, angry farmers in Massachusetts, who are very upset because they've lost the right to vote, they've had no pension, they've lost their farms to unfair taxes in Massachusetts, they rise up and threaten, most of them veterans, they threaten to take over the state armory in Springfield, Massachusetts. This was known as Shays's Rebellion, after Daniel Shays, a veteran of Saratoga and many other battles in the Revolution. And Shays's Rebellion is eventually put down. And it's that moment that convinces men like Washington and James Madison that the country needs a better government and a better constitution. And certainly, that was one of the key elements in forcing Congress to call for the Constitutional Convention in 1787. And when they do that, and when they begin their debates, once again back in Philadelphia, the question for a need for America's army is front and center. The Constitution was being discussed in 1787. James Madison warned. He was really serious. He did not like the idea of a standing army. He said it would be a standing military force with an overgrown executive will not be long safe companions to liberty. Elbridge Gerry, famous Massachusetts politician, I should say his name is really pronounced Gerry, Elbridge Gerry, he spoke for many of those founders at the Constitutional Convention when he mockingly compared a standing army to the, how can I say this delicately, the male member. He said it was an excellent assurance of domestic tranquility, but a dangerous invitation to foreign adventure. That was Gary's views about having an army. So that derision and that fear of a standing army permeated many of the founding fathers' ideas about having an army, along with their frugality. They were cheapskates. They didn't want to spend it. After the war was over, the United States Army was reduced to about 800 men. It didn't work out very well when they had their first wars with Native Americans. But this has led to a long tradition in this country, I believe, of paying lip service to America's fighting forces with this simplistic cherry tree version of history that we teach our children and still tell ourselves. Today, of course, there's a nearly daily cascade of stories of scandal, neglect. It's sad, but it's a very, very long history of the way we treat the men and now the women who fight and wear the nation's uniform. Since the nation was born, America's soldiers and sailors have often gotten the short end of the stick. In the Revolution, Washington had to beg for troops to be fed, for cloth to clothe his men, for boots, for ammunition. There's a famous letter he writes from Valley Forge where he says, one of my servants is nearly naked at Valley Forge. He probably wasn't nearly naked himself. He probably had a pretty good uniform on. But presumably that naked servant is that same William Lee I mentioned earlier. In the Civil War, the word shoddy became commonly used to describe Union uniforms, right up to Iraq, where we have the ill-equipped trucks and equipment given to our men and women as they serve. America has always talked a very good game about honoring its troops, but it has rarely delivered on that promise. In the aftermath of World War I, when the Veterans Bureau was created to handle the immense medical needs of the returning doughboys. We've all heard all of the scandals recently about the Veterans Bureau, but it was born in scandal. The first member of the cabinet at the Veterans level bureau was actually sent to prison for fraud and corruption. The current disgrace at the VA hospitals, the alarming suicide statistics, the homelessness, the high drug abuse, the frightening accounts of post-traumatic stress disorder, all of these issues among veterans are very much modern vestiges of the founders' deep disdain for what they called the men of the blade. So on occasions like Flag Day or Army Day or Patriots Day or the 4th of July or Memorial Day or Veterans Day, go down the list, history is observed. We like to thank our troops. We see them in the airport and we thank them for their service. We have the flyovers at the stadium these days, which we now learn the Army has paid for and the NFL teams have actually accepted money for, which was another scandal we could pick up on. But these simplistic soundbite thank yous for service are rooted in this kind of fake populist pride that goes back to the time of the Revolution. So let's acknowledge instead that there is a mistrust that led to the elevation of this Minuteman myth to the great American gospel. And let's tell the real story. And that's what I've tried to do in this new book, The Hidden History of America at War. It is the story of the men, mostly men in these stories, who have fought for us. It's the story, as I mentioned, of going back to the Revolution, of African Americans who served, usually without recognition. It was a story of their service in the Civil War, the second chapter of the book, which is about Petersburg and the siege there when the US colored troops were first allowed to fight and performed valiantly, but also were usually given the tasks like burying the dead or being in the most forward positions and certainly being paid less than their white fellow servicemen. After the war, they became the so-called Buffalo Soldiers. These are real stories. the fascinating little piece of the Buffalo Soldier story that I tell in the third chapter, which is about Balangiga in the Philippines, a really piece of hidden history, because most people have forgotten about the Spanish-American War and why we were in the Philippines in the first place. But one of the things that the Army did was bring the Buffalo Soldiers from the West to Florida to send them to Cuba to fight, because they believed that African-American soldiers were resistant to tropical diseases. They called them immunes. This was an idea that went back to slave times, when people believed, oh, the Africans can come here and they won't get all these tropical diseases because they come from Africa. Of course, the death rates from yellow fever and malaria had nothing to do with being immune to disease because you were African American. But these are the stories that permeate the history of America at War. It's part of the history I try and tell in this book, and it's also a history that connects past to present. One of the things I discovered as I wrote the very last chapter of the book, which is about the war in Iraq, and specifically the battle for Fallujah in May of 2004, was that the men who went into Fallujah, the Marines who went into Fallujah in May of 2004, went in with their bayonets fixed. Now, that might not seem surprising to you, except that it is 2004, and here we have the most high-tech army in the world with drones and cyber warfare. But these Marines go into this city to retake this hard-scrabble Iraqi city with fixed bayonets. It's interesting to me because on that night when George Washington orders the assault at Yorktown in October of 1781, he tells Alexander Hamilton and the Marquis de Lafayette and another extraordinary fellow named Jack Lawrence that he wants the men to go in with cold steel. In other words, to fix bayonets. He doesn't want a shot fired. He wants these two small British outposts to be taken without firing any shots, to be done in silence, and to do it quickly, hand-to-hand combat. And I was struck by this extraordinary contrast between Washington ordering those men in 1781 and the Marines going into Fallujah in 2004, exactly the same way. So much has changed over those 230, nearly 240 years. But some things don't change. And the way that men go into war has remained the same. And that's what this book is ultimately about. Asking questions: who fights our battles? Why do we go to war? What is a good war? I start the book out with a quote from Benjamin Franklin saying, in 1783, around the time that Washington is saying farewell here, there was never a good war or a bad peace. Part of what I've tried to explore in this book is whether Franklin is right or not. Are there good wars? Are there bad peaces? I believe he's incorrect. I think that there have been good wars. I think they're very, very few and far between. And certainly, the most important thing that we can do as citizens is ask those questions. But we can't ask the questions unless we know the real story. And that's why these stories of what these men did throughout our history are so important for us to learn and to understand. Thank you very much. Now, if I may, you probably know that my Don't Know Much About series of books is written as a series of questions and answers, and I really like questions, so I hope we can have some here tonight. I ask questions in those books that are as rudimentary as what does the Declaration of Independence declare, or why is there a statue of Benedict Arnold's boot? If anybody's curious, I'll be happy to explain. But it seems to me that history is really about asking questions and getting questions, so I really would welcome any questions here. I think that because we have C-SPAN here, we want to hear the questions on a microphone, so please raise your hand if you have a question, comment, right behind you there.
First, big fan. I'm also one of the teenagers who read your book.
You make me feel so old.
Oh, thanks, Gary. Cool. Cool. So you mentioned the first chapter is revolution, second chapter is the Civil War, and you talk about, you know, there are bad wars and good wars. And so you didn't include, you know, 1812 and the war with Mexico. And could you maybe talk a bit more about that?
Okay. What six battles and wars did I choose, and why did I leave some of the other ones out? It's a great question. There are six battles. Yorktown, 1781. Petersburg, Virginia, Civil War, 1864 to 1865. I write about that because it is one of the overlooked. We know about Gettysburg, we know about Atlanta burning, we know about Antietam and Shiloh, but Petersburg really gets overlooked, and it's unfortunate for a number of reasons. It really is the final point at which Lee and Grant are battling face to face. But it's also the story of the people of Petersburg caught between two warring armies and the fact that they were starved and were starving as this nearly year-long siege goes on. And again, it's a fascinating story of what war really does to the people who are affected by it. The third chapter is about the war in the Philippines, the Spanish-American War, an obscure war for most Americans today. The chapter is called The Water Cure, and I was particularly drawn to this story because the water cure was a form of enhanced interrogation, as we call it today. Prisoners were laid on the ground and water was poured down their throat until they were basically drowning. Sounds just like waterboarding, doesn't it? But it was happening in the Philippines 100 years ago. Now, this isn't a historian coming up with this story by digging into some vast, you know, secret documents. This was actually a controversy that reached all the way to the White House in a scandal that was the subject of a Senate hearing while Theodore Roosevelt was in his first term in the White House. So if we want to talk about learning from history, we have to understand the history. And the story of the Philippines and what happened there, young Americans being sent off to a jungle in Asia at the turn of the 20th century and committing atrocities and getting involved with torture, we can certainly learn a lot from that story, but we didn't. The fourth story is a bit of a departure, but a really fascinating one, I think, because it's the story of the Battle of Berlin, which got left out of my school books and certainly the Hollywood telling of history that I grew up with. I learned about Iwo Jima and I learned about D-Day, but not about the fall of the capital of Germany, perhaps the most significant event in World War II, because it leads to the death of Hitler and the end of the Thousand-Year Reich. Well, why didn't we hear about it? Because the Soviets did it. And by the time the war was over, the Soviets were no longer our allies, but our Cold War enemy. So that whole chapter of what happened in Berlin really gets left out of so many history books, just as the role of the Soviets is very, very unfamiliar to many Americans who are surprised to learn that approximately 27 million people in Russia died during what we call World War II and they call the Great Patriotic War. A few weeks ago, we had the celebration, a very muted celebration here, I thought, of the 70th anniversary of VE Day, Victory in Europe Day. There were some old planes that flew over Washington, D.C. The same day in Moscow, between 300 and 500,000 people marched carrying pictures of the people who had died during the war. It's a very salient part of their history, and certainly a part of their history that we have to understand when we're looking at what's going on in Russia today. So again, we can talk about learning from history, but if we don't know it, we can't learn it. The story of Berlin is also rather ghastly because of the extraordinary degree of mass rape that took place there of German women. Now, I have to add that that was in retribution for what the Germans had done to Russian women when they invaded Russia. And this is the horrible side of war that we often leave out of the movies and the history books. The other aspect of Berlin that's so important is that it immediately went from the division of Berlin and the fall of Berlin to the beginnings of the Cold War. As soon as United States, American troops began to arrive in Berlin in July 70 years ago, there was tension right away. actually Soviet soldiers were shot by Americans in a number of instances. And so the Cold War that was about to begin really gets its beginnings in Berlin in 1945. So that's another piece of the hidden history that I try and bring out. The last two chapters are much more contemporary. The story of Hue during the Tet Offensive in Vietnam. This one's particularly important because we remember seeing the scenes in Saigon, but Hue kind of gets overlooked. A beautiful city called the Citadel City. It was the home of the Vietnamese emperor for a long time, and it had really been spared most of the fighting in the Indochina War for 20 years. But in Tet, February 1968, all hell breaks loose there. And in an office on 57th Street in New York, Walter Cronkite hears the teletype machines clattering, and he starts to read these reports, and he says, "What the hell is going on? I thought we were winning this war." Because he had believed what the Pentagon had been telling him and the rest of America, that the war, you know, the end of this was in sight, light at the end of the tunnel, all the cliches we know. So Walter Cronkite, who was a veteran of World War II as a correspondent, got his flak jacket and his uniform back out, and he goes to Vietnam to look at what's going on. And some of you may be old enough, I certainly am, to remember that extraordinary night in February 1968 when Walter Cronkite told America that we were losing the war. And it was right after that that Lyndon Johnson decided not to run again. So one of the lessons, by the way, a general said of Vietnam was not to let television cameras on the battlefield. And that's certainly the story in that chapter, how the reporters became as much of the story as the soldiers were. And finally, Fallujah, a story which obviously hasn't really ended yet. Certainly when the Marines left in 2004, they didn't think that they would see that city fall 10 years later to forces related to Al-Qaeda, now what we call ISIS. So that war, that battle continues. That's a very, very quick overview of 230 years of military history. I did leave some wars out, of course, and I could have chosen many others. But I chose these battles because each was emblematic in some way of something very important in the nation's history, in its relationship with the military, and how we see the people who fight, and how the military has changed. It's really only, as many of you know, since 1960, when Eisenhower left and gave his farewell address, that we had the warning of this military-industrial complex. Until World War II, really, Americans had fought wars, gone back to business. But World War II obviously changed that with the creation of what Roosevelt calls the arsenal of democracy. And it changed, and it's changed forever. And that's something else we have to confront and certainly understand. Way too many of us don't have any connection to the military anymore. So we read these stories and we push them off. It's somebody else's business, but it really is our business. That's a roundabout answer to your question. I hope I covered everything. Somebody else.
Yeah, I had a question. Thank you. Getting back to Yorktown, one of the myths that I had sort of grown up with was not only that Washington performed heroically, but that somehow Cornwallis, Lord Cornwallis, was somehow incompetent in his dealings. But then later on, I've come to learn that actually Cornwallis was a very venerated and accomplished in the European theater in India and whatnot, had been very successful. So where do you stand on that?
He certainly was a veteran with all the honors, but he did not do a very good job in the South from about 1780 on. And he and Clinton, who was the commander-in-chief of the British forces in North America, who was here in New York, were at each other's throat. So when you talk about generals backbiting and generals fighting for credit and generals deciding that he doesn't know what he's talking about, all of that happened in the Revolution too. So Cornwallis certainly was an honored and decorated veteran, but he did not perform well when he came to America in the American South. And the fact that he was really allowed himself to be trapped on this rather small peninsula, which Yorktown is, where a French Navy, and the French Navy was crucial in the Battle of Yorktown, was able to come in and cut him off and allow Washington and Washington's army and then the French army to come in and start this siege, was really the was a terrible strategic disaster for that Cornwallis has to be blamed for. He would, of course, blame Clinton for not sending him enough troops, and they would write angry letters for the rest of their lives about who was really to blame for that, just as other generals in our history have gone back and forth about mistakes in American history. But no, it wasn't his proudest moment. Interestingly, though, again, these are the little threads I love. He goes back to England on the same boat that takes Benedict Arnold back to England. What conversations the two of them must have had. And Benedict Arnold's, you know, role in the revolution is so fascinating. I mentioned Benedict Arnold's boot being a question in one of my books, but Arnold had been truly one of the heroes of the early American Revolution. And again, ambition, ego, pride. He feels like he's passed over at every turn, that other men get promotions above him. He's wounded at Saratoga, very, very important battle in the Revolution. He's wounded at Saratoga, but still leads a charge that helps turn the tide of battle that day. And when the time came to honor those who fought at Saratoga and led it to Saratoga, they put up statues and they left one niche empty. But someone felt that Arnold's heroism and his leadership that day should be marked. So there is this marble plinth at Saratoga, which is a boot. And it doesn't say it's Arnold's boot, but it is, because he was wounded in his leg that day and never walked properly again after that. His boots had to be adjusted because one of his legs was eventually shorter than the other. So that's why there's a statue of Arnold's boot at Saratoga, New York. But again, fascinating character study of this man who was very close to Washington. Washington admired him. Washington trusted him. But he and his very ambitious and young wife had other ideas about what would happen. So again, I'd love to be on that boat ride back with Cornwallis and Benedict Arnold to London and hear what the two of them talked about. I'll let you pick. There are lots of hands. Over here? Yeah, and then right in the back after that. Yeah, go ahead, please.
Yeah, hi, I'm a descendant of someone who was a Culpeper Minute Man who fought in Great Bridge and was one of 3,000 militia who fought with Lafayette and Steuben in Virginia, since the Regulars had been wiped out at Charleston and Camden for the most part, and was in Yorktown. But in generally, I am very supportive of your approach to consideration of the Continentals, a large percentage of whom were, as you point out, immigrants, and the Irish were mostly Presbyterians at that time. The Catholics came a little bit later, and in Pennsylvania, New York, Connecticut, Rhode Island, more than 50% of the soldiers were actually foreign born.
Yes.
And one of the questions I had, and I don't know if your book gets to it or your research has went into it, was the payment of the enlisted men, because we know that they got paid in largely worthless scrip, which was bought up by speculators and which was later redeemed at par. And we also know that Newburgh conspiracy was about taking care of the officers. And the officers did get taken care of, but the enlisted men didn't get pensions until much later. And I wonder if you had some comment on that.
I do have comment. I mentioned, first of all, thank you very much for that. And I want to add here, I'm not painting militia with, you know, they're all a bunch of cowards who went home. Certainly many militiamen performed admirably and heroically, and there are cases that I document. But I mentioned, for instance, the men in Harrisburg. They were enlisted men who march on Philadelphia because they hadn't been paid and also wanted pensions. I mentioned in the book also the fact that in 1781, early in 1781, Washington is really desperate because things really look horrible, and he has mutinies, at least two massive mutinies, first among the men of the Pennsylvania line, He sends troops up to them, actually negotiates with them, and settles that. Then some men from New Jersey, also who apparently stopped by the Tipling House, also rebel, and Washington then sends troops in to put this one down, and actually has the ringleaders of that mutiny executed by firing squad, and he puts some of the other mutineers in the firing squad, so they are expected to execute the leaders of this rebellion. So there are many, many other cases of this happening, and I mentioned the extraordinary Shays' rebellion. Also, men who were expecting pensions and needed them in 1787, leading to the crisis of the Constitutional Convention. But one story above all stands out for me, and I tell the story because I write so much about a fellow named Joseph Plum Martin. And if you've read Revolutionary History, you know that name. He was a kid who enlisted when he was about 16 and served through the entire war. Much later in his life, he wrote an account of that anonymously. It came out under the name of A Yankee Doodle Dandy. And this is the best narrative account we have of a real grunt's eye view of the revolution. Well, I only discovered almost by accident that Joseph Plum Martin went up to Maine to have a farm. And he was also struggling, not getting his pension. And he lived on property that belonged to Henry Knox, Washington's head of artillery. Knox throws him off the property because he says it's not his property. It's this extraordinary moment of bringing together these two characters. Joseph Plum Martin had dug the trenches that Henry Knox put the cannons in at Yorktown. But later in life, they're arguing over property, and Martin gets thrown off Knox's land. Knox, by the way, later dies of choking on a chicken bone. Not to say that there's any justice in that or anything, but just a curiosity that the man who survived 8 years of the revolution chokes on a chicken bone and ends also in serious debt because he'd things had not turned out well for him either. But here, it's just the same story again about how the fighting man, the revolutionary soldier, was usually not taken care of. And I'm sure you know the expression, not worth a continental. That expression comes from the fact that the soldiers were paid with continental paper money, which was not worth a continental. The very...
When Washington addresses his troops at Newburgh,
yes.
The meeting house has been reconstructed as part of the encampment is still there. Mm-hmm. And when he addresses the troops, isn't there a bit about him pausing and taking out his spectacles?
In fact, he does. I quote it here. He said he takes out his spectacles and says, I never had to use these before, but you know, I'm getting old and my eyes are getting bad, essentially. So it's this very poignant moment where Washington is reading.
Is something about some of the officers actually weep?
There are very many moments of Washington's officers, certainly here, they wept that night in 1783. And that is a tribute to the complete love and devotion they had for him. And the fact that he was able to put that conspiracy down really is a reflection, I think, of that degree of love and affection. And I am getting the high sign here from Jennifer. No?
Finish your thought.
Oh, no, that was my thought. I don't know if we have time for any more questions, though. So thank you very much for coming and your attention.
I'm the leading state sponsor of terrorism.